we talked a bit about the hardware. You know, mm-hmm. people are working on the hardware and quantum computing.
Yep.
What about software? Where do you start thinking about that? Where does that come from?
Writing software for a quantum computer, in my opinion, is actually not very, very different from how we write software for just a normal computer. And we think about software in terms of being able to write down instructions for the computer, and the computer executing these instructions, changing some internal state. When I write instructions for any type of computer, whether it be like a modern MacBook Pro or an old PDP-11, in both cases, in the end, we have an assembly code that gets executed that's changing the memory, the disk, the registers in your CPU, and so on. And it's not different with a quantum computer. It's just like, the question is, what are we changing, and how do we change them? We can really describe these things in quite simple terms. If we were to do this with sort of full textbook honesty, we would discuss things like finite dimensional vector spaces and Hilbert spaces and linear operators and unitary maps and all that stuff. And all that stuff is very, very important if you're actually sitting down writing a program. But to get an understanding of it, I think we can do away with it and actually just think about things in terms of simple probabilities. So the idea of a qubit.
So a qubit is a bit in a quantum computer, right?
Yep, it is, yeah, it's sort of the fundamental building block. It's like a bit in a regular computer. The way I think of it is it's a resource in the computer. It's a resource that you can use to perform a computation. So a qubit to me is anything, it's sort of abstract, but anything that has two states of being and some possibility or probability of those states. So for instance, we can think about photons and their polarization. A photon can be sort of polarized left and right, or it can be polarized up and down. But if we're not looking, then maybe it's possibly in one or the other. Maybe it's 50% moving and traversing left and right and 50% moving up and down. This is just for photons. Turns out there are lots and lots of different ways to construct qubits. The qubits that we work on in the so-called field of superconducting quantum computation, we use a device called a superconducting charge qubit. It doesn't matter all the details, but it suffices to say that the two states there are, is there charge or is there no charge in this circuit? And then, of course, we have the same thing. We could have a probability, like maybe there's a 10% chance there's a charge, or maybe there's a 90% chance there's a charge. These are called superconducting charge qubits. Again, it sounds complicated, but the essence is the same. Two states, but maybe it's in one or the other. The interesting thing, though, is when we have multiple qubits, and this is really where the power of quantum computation happens. And we can actually think of it sort of simply diagrammatically, that if qubits, if I just represent them sort of as a circle here, maybe we have three, the idea is that these qubits can interact. This guy can interact with this guy can interact with this guy, and these can interact with one another. And every time we add a qubit, if we were to add a circle here, let's say we added this fourth qubit right here, we notice that every single one of them can now interact with it. We have to draw lots of these lines. It turns out that a quantum computer can deal with these additions of qubits in a very efficient fashion. But like I said, a qubit is something where it has two states. So each of these guys can be in two states with a particular probability. Let's say the two states now are just 0 and 1. Our qubit can be 0 or 1 or possibly something in between. So if I write down these qubits with a probability, let's say we have 3 qubits here. I'll call it Q0, Q1, and Q2. What we have is that qubit 0, let's say it's this one right here, 1 and 2. Well, qubit 0 could be in 0 or 1, so it has some probability of being in 0. Qubit 1 also has some probability of being in 0, and qubit 0 also has some probability of being in 0. Maybe that's a 10% chance. But now we have to painstakingly go through and write every one. Qubit 0 has a probability of being in the 0 state, qubit 1 also 0, and qubit 2 1. And we can write down all these possibilities, et cetera, et cetera, until we get to the possibility that all of them are 1. And each of them has a probability. Maybe this is 5%, maybe this is 7%, maybe this is like 35%. Maybe there's a very high percentage chance that all of them are 1, 8%, and so on. So every time we add a qubit, the size of this table doubles. The number of probability percentages doubles. And it turns out that these probabilities right here are ultimately what a quantum computer is computing with. When we do an instruction on a quantum computer, when we instruct it to do something, in the end, it's always about changing these probabilities to favor some computation that we're trying to do. When we start up a quantum computer, when we flick the switch on, it'll start as 100% in this state, and everything else will be 0%. We start off here, and we know that we start off here. It might be that when we apply a certain operation, so for example, an operation is the so-called superposition initialization, or we call it Hadamard initialization. This is if we have any number of qubits that are starting off in zero, and maybe we want every probability to be equal. So if we want to start off here, we do something called Hadamard initialization, where we do a particular instruction called the Hadamard gate. And what happens is this 100% now turns into, let's say we just have one qubit, it would be 50% chance in the zero state and 50% chance in the one state. If we had two qubits, Hadamard initialization would cause us to be 25% chance with both qubits being zero, 25% chance 0, 1, 25% chance being 1, 0, 25% chance being 1, 1. The point is that this particular instruction, it's one instruction on a quantum computer, allows us to change these probabilities in a way that we'd like. And it might be useful for us to do something like this Hadamard initialization with all the probabilities being equal, because then from here, we could do some operation that affects all these qubits and affects all these probabilities sort of in the same way. But like I said, this is just one possible instruction.
How many instructions are there?
So there can be an infinite number, just like a normal computer. It's not that there are an infinite number of instructions, it's that there are an infinite number of possible things you could do with the instructions. So one of the greatest discoveries was that we can arrange these probabilities to be in whatever way that we'd like using five instructions total. There are sort of five different ways that we can permute these things and change them, and they're this. One is called a measure instruction. Measure instruction is pretty important because while we're talking about probabilities, we can't actually see these probabilities in the quantum computer. They're just in there. At some point, we do want to see, are they zeros or ones? Like, we need to answer that question. So the measure instruction will take any list of probabilities and turn it into one of them will change to 100%. So each of these is 25% chance. It'll pick one, let's say it's this one right here, and measure is going to make this 100% with the other ones being 0%. That's one way of changing. And then, incidentally, we also get to read out from the quantum computer that it was a 1, 0. That's how we get our answers. That's the only way we get an answer, in fact, from the quantum computer. The rest of them are just purely ways of changing these probabilities. There are lots of different ways you can have instructions, just like regular computers. Every single computer that's ever been built, or every single CPU that's ever been built, always has a different instruction set. One possible instruction set is the following. We have this Hadamard.
Is that named after someone?
Yes, it's named after, I think he was a mathematician. He worked on a variety of mathematical subjects, and there's a matrix that's actually 1 divided by square root of 2, 1, 1, 1, negative 1, which is the so-called Hadamard matrix. Incidentally, this is also used to represent how these probabilities change. So Hadamard is one instruction. There's another instruction called phase. Again, it just has the effect of changing probabilities around in a particular way. There's another instruction called the T gate, not very creatively named. There's another instruction called the C not gate. And what's special about the C not gate is that all of these right here act on one qubit. We say, I want to do a measure on qubit 2, or I want to do a T gate on qubit 0. And it sort of affects only one qubit. It'll affect a lot of probabilities, because even though we're operating on one qubit here, it accounts for this entire column, so it actually changes all the probabilities. C not as special is because we get to choose two qubits. This is how we get this interaction between them. So C not, you can say, I want to do this on qubit 0 and qubit 2, for instance. And this itself is an instruction in the sort of quantum assembly code.
Are these instructions a bit like gates?
Yeah, so they are like gates, but there's an interesting reversal. For example, an AND gate is something like this, where data is coming into the gate and data comes out of the gate. What's interesting about these gates in quantum computation is sort of the opposite. You have data that's sitting there, all these probabilities, and you like apply the gate to the machine and all the probabilities change. So you're not sending data into the gate. You're not putting this gate on the chip. Like an AND gate, for instance, is a gate that you would actually etch into a chip. Here, it's an instruction that you apply to the computer, and it changes these probabilities. But nonetheless, they're both different operations that you do on data.
And how does what you do as code get changed into what these operations and instructions?
Yeah, so like with normal computers, you can write these instructions out as assembly code. In fact, one example is, say I want the following probabilities. I have 00011011. I want this. I want it to be 50% chance to be 00 or 50% chance to be 11. This is called a Bell state. With a Bell state, it's interesting because theoretically, let's suppose I have a qubit. Let's suppose I could hold a qubit. And let's say I gave you a qubit. It's 50% chance 00, 50% chance 11. So even if we traveled halfway across the world and I decided to measure my qubit with a measure instruction and I determined that's a zero, then I know for certain that you must be a zero because there's a 0% chance that we're different. But somehow we determine this, it's a 50% chance. It's not that it is already chosen, it literally is 50% chance. You don't know which one it is. So we can write a program to construct a Bell state. I won't explain exactly why it works this way, but you do a Hadamard on my qubit, qubit zero. We do a C0 on my qubit and your qubit, and we're done. This is a quantum program. You can write this out. Now, there are higher levels of quantum programming where we don't want to restrict ourselves to these instructions. Maybe I want to more directly express the probabilities and how I want them to change. They all have to add up to one, of course. I mean, we have a certain percentage chance. It has to be 100% in the end. But maybe I want to shift the probabilities around in a particular way, but not in any of the ways that's in our gate set. I can write that down and I can use something called a quantum compiler, a piece of software that converts what I want into these native instructions. And that gives me the next level of abstraction in the code. We can go all the way up to using a full-blown library for writing this stuff. One library that we've constructed is something called PyQuil, which allows us to actually write Python code to express quantum computations. And Quil is actually this instruction set here. Quil stands for Quantum Instruction Language, which lets you write down this assembly code.
And who came up with these things? Is this a commercial thing or is this a wider?
Yeah, so Quil was originally this particular type of instruction set was a paper that I actually wrote a while ago. The idea of gates and everything was very well known for many decades previous to that. So this is a particular encoding of gates as instructions. PyQuil is a library that's open source, it's free, there are no restrictions really on using it to construct these programs, but it does allow you to actually connect up to Rigetti Computing's real quantum computers if you so please to actually run your programs. But if you don't want to connect up to the quantum computers and you just want to simulate on your own laptop, this can connect up to an open source simulation tool that we have. If you just kind of want to see how these probabilities change and so on.
So somebody could write a Hello World program in Python and run it on a quantum computer?
Not quite. You still have to express a quantum computation. So a quantum computer doesn't print things out. It's manipulating these probabilities. So at some point you still have to express things as quantum instructions. So definitely if you wanted to make a Bell state, writing the Bell state program, you could do that. But could you write Hello World? No. And this goes back to the fact that the quantum computer is a coprocessor. It's just like saying you don't write Hello World on your GPU generally. You don't express any particular computation and you also don't compile Python into code on your GPU. You write special code within Python that gets run on your GPU. And it's the same thing with quantum computing.
And I know you said there are sort of stability issues. Do you get hard answers out of this, or is it a probability?
So when an answer comes out, when you measure, you do get a definite answer out. However, since there's noise, what we have to do is write our program, get an answer out, and store that, and actually rerun it multiple times. We have to gather statistics about the answer. And it turns out the more you do this, the more accurate your answers become. And that is to account for noise in the quantum computer currently.
So we're talking about setting these probabilities to what you want them to be. And I understand kind of like running operations on gates to do sums in a traditional computer. It does sound like you know the answer.
Yeah, no, you don't know the answer. You just show that if you were to do this series of operations that you'd get the right answer out. And the answer might be different depending on, of course, the answer will be different depending on the problem that you have. So for instance, one of the main questions a quantum computer can solve is the same question that you can get from something called the Fourier transform, where you can find if you have like a sound wave and you want to find what frequencies it has. You know that if you run the Fourier transform, proven using mathematics and so on, that the answer will be the set of frequencies that make up that sound. Likewise here, there's actually something called a quantum Fourier transform, where if you run it, you know that probabilities will accumulate on the answers or the frequencies maybe that your sound wave has. So you know just by the construction of your program that you'll get the correct answer, not that you know the correct answer itself at the front end. And that's the same with classical computing, in my opinion. You rarely do you know what the final answer is. You just know the computation or the program that you've written will produce the correct answer.
Okay. So just one last question, because a lot of those percentages were based on multiple qubits. You need more than one qubit to make this work.
You can use a qubit. If you have a normal qubit, your table is going to look like this. You're going to have prob, and maybe it's like 50%, 50%, and your states are just 0 and 1. Except there's just not very many useful things you can do with a single qubit. The power really comes from multiple qubits because you get this nice scaling law where if you have n qubits, the number of probabilities that you get to work with is 2 to the power of n. So every single additional qubit, you're doubling the number of probabilities that you get to work with.
I think I get it. I think the thing is knowing these sort of sets of percentages, these probabilities beforehand, it's really hard to get your head around what a program is actually doing and predicting.
How do you know how to do that for a regular computer, though?
Well, I suppose with a regular computer, if you're adding numbers together, you know, an arithmetic logic unit will just add numbers together, right? And so you put in the zeros and ones in the various gates, and something comes out.
It's the same thing with a quantum computer. Your input is a bunch of probabilities, which you know at the very start, and all these gates change those probabilities in a controlled way. You know exactly how Hadamard or phase or T or C naught, you know exactly how it's going to change those, and you can write down exactly how it'll change those. So you can mechanically do the computation in the same way that we can mechanically do it with adders or ALUs or whatever. It just turns out that the most basic type of computation is actually a really large one. It's actually equivalent to a big matrix multiply. If you were to write this out, your probabilities as a column vector, 50%, 25%, whatever, 7%, et cetera, et cetera. Every operation on a quantum computer is actually specified as a matrix. You have a big set of matrix elements. Maybe it's like 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1/2, 3/4, whatever. I'm making it up as I go along, of course. But you know with certainty, 100% certainty, that this operation, maybe this is like Hadamard on qubit 0 and Hadamard on qubit 1 or something like that. It's not, but you know that this operation is going to change these probabilities. And I could, if I wanted to, manually go and compute this matrix multiplication. The thing is, like I said, this vector right here grows, doubles in size every time I add a qubit. So it's better for a quantum computer to do it as opposed to me or even a normal computer doing it.
So it's a bit like the parallelism of a GPU.
Yes.
It's really good at doing lots of things at the same time.
Yep. This multiplication happens on the order of 50 to 250 nanoseconds on a computer. No matter the number of qubits that you have, even if you have 250 qubits, this vector right here would be 2 to the power of 250, which is some enormously large number. I don't even know an order of magnitude estimate of what that is. It's so bigger than any computer on Earth could store, bigger than any computer in the universe could store. But nonetheless, it will do this multiplication in 50 nanoseconds, which really starts getting into why quantum computers show promise for very fast or very powerful applications.
How much does a quantum computer cost then?
Oh my gosh. All the components, it costs a great deal, for sure, if you want to buy one and have it in your living room.
What actual applications do the quantum coprocessors have at the
moment? So one of the big popular ones is a very recent algorithm, back in, I think, 2014 is when it came out, is this variational quantum eigensolver. The technical description...